Flash Gordon star Sam J. Jones talks possible sequel storylines 40 years on. A defeated Ming the Merciless unskewers his own body from the pointy nose of the careening aircraft that just crashed and burned into the Imperial Palace, upsetting his wedding ceremony and piercing him through his belly in the process. After he steadies himself, the despotic ruler is confronted by the man responsible. New York Jets quarterback Flash Gordon, tricked and taken into space by a certain Dr. Hans Zarkov fleeing Ming's attack on Earth, has united the warring populations of Mongo to face off against their common enemy. And now, about to claim victory, the Earthling football star brandishes a garish golden sword over an Emperor Ming, spilling green blood from the hole in his middle. Conceding defeat in this particular battle, Ming activates his magical ring and dematerializes right before our eyes. The ring clatters to the floor. A timer counts down to zero. Long live Flash. You've saved your Earth. Have a nice day, says the floating security robot. Prince Baron steps forward and Hawkmen leader Vulton declares the mustachioed Aborian leader the new ruler of Mongo. Baron promptly ushers in a new era of peace. But is Ming dead? It seems not. Famously, the closing moments of Flash Gordon show a black-gloved hand reaching in to pick up the ring from the floor. Then Ming's laughter can be heard. The words, "the end," appear before a question mark emerges. This is the denouement to the cult classic, color-drenched 1980 big-screen version of the popular 1930s comic book, the film George Lucas wanted to make before being denied the rights and crafting his own space adventure. You might have heard of it. In celebration of its 40th anniversary, we're looking back on the Mike Hodges-directed wonder with Flash Gordon himself, Sam J. Jones, talking about a long-delayed sequel, as well as sexy execution shorts, an overdue meeting with the other Flash from the film, resurrecting a long-forgotten TV series, and memories of dearly departed cinema icon Max von Sydow. The end? So what did happen there at the end? I'm probing for an answer to a question fans still debate today, and also looking for hints towards what might have transpired in a planned follow-up. "I think it's pretty obvious," says Jones, grinning. "We don't know if that was his hand or was it Clytus's hand that picked up the ring. Was it somebody else's hand with the glove on? We don't know." Clytus, Ming's right-hand man, was apparently killed following the duel with Flash on the spiked platform at the Hawkmen Sky City. How could you forget his eyes and tongue bulging out of his skull? Thank goodness the scene remains intact in the 4K restoration. If we know anything about comic book stories, however, it's that death isn't always final. Perhaps it's Clytus, then, picking up at some point after the events of the film to snatch the ring and absorb Ming's essence from it to become Ming II, as one fan theory has it. Another prominent fan theory suggests that the hand that reaches in and grabs the item of jewelry does indeed belong to Ming himself. The theory goes that after having transported himself via the jewel, which acts as a portal to the alternate dimension he potentially came from, Ming returns after a period of healing to collect the ring and wreak havoc on Mongo once more. "That sounds good," says Jones, "but you don't know. I think it's a great concept, and it could work in a sequel." "I think people are ready for anything," he says. "I mean, it has to make sense, obviously. Just don't do a sequel for sequel's sake. You want to be true to the inherent characteristics and loyal to the character of Flash. Obviously, you want to maintain that. All the Flash Gordon comic books from the 30s on, there are so many unique stories that could work in a sequel. We didn't even get into it in the first part, with the Lion Men, the Lion Women, the women who are from Arborea. What's next for Flash and Dale?" The conversation turns back to the ending of the 80s classic, and whether Flash and Dale Arden would have returned to Earth. Arden expresses a desire to go back to New York in her closing lines. "They should return, but they should be called back," says Jones. "The only reason why they can't return immediately is because they don't have the proper jet propulsion on Mongo. But maybe Zarkov can design that. So I think they should return after Zarkov designs that, and then they'll be called back to Mongo again, because maybe there's another villain that's raised its head against Prince Baron, now King Baron, right? Or another planet invaded." All great jumping off points for the follow-up fans are still waiting for. Not that there hasn't been talk over the years. multiple different reputable producers have been involved for whatever reason, and they've come pretty close laterally, with Kick-Ass and Kingsman director Matthew Vaughn volunteering to tackle a live-action follow-up not so long ago. The story goes that at the time of filming the original, Jones fell out with producer Dino De Laurentiis, and that nixed plans to shoot a second movie. Some reports say a sequel was slated to shoot straight after the first to take full advantage of the sets. Indeed, director Mike Hodges was initially approached not to helm this one. Don't Look Now director Nicholas Roeg was already on board to take charge of Flash Gordon 1, but to take charge of writing and directing the sequel, before Roeg and De Laurentiis parted ways and Hodges was drafted in to take over duties on the cult original. I met with 20th Century Fox 5.5 years ago, explains Jones of the resurrected sequel discussions. They were going to do a live action, they brought Matthew Vaughn on board. And so Disney came in after 5 years, having bought Fox, and they said, great idea about the live-action Flash Gordon, but we're gonna hold off right now. We're going to do an animated version with Taika Waititi. Okay, that's the way it is, but I'd love to be part of it. In fact, he goes so far as to say he'd want to be Flash, and fans surely wouldn't argue with that. I'd want to be Flash Gordon, he explains. We all understand the formulas for the movie. You always have to have the younger, good-looking guy and good-looking girl, of course. We know that. You have to. That's part of the formula. But you've also got to have the seasoned, rugged, mature guy, like me, like Flash Gordon, a guy that's been around. A sequel could feasibly feature Jones as an older Flash and a younger hero who potentially is the son of Flash and Dale Arden. If for some reason the Disney live-action sequel isn't going to happen, I'd love to be in a position in the future to make it happen myself, he adds. Disney, watch out. So what would his version look like? Here's a clue. Of course, Ornella Muti as Princess Aura, the way she was dressed, and Melody Anderson as Dale, and Mariangela Mulatto as Kayla, he says. It's a visual masterpiece. So if they just keep a sequel inherent to that, the visual masterpiece with the production design and the costumes and being true to the characters, you'll have great success. Sexy execution shorts. I wonder if being true to the costumes means the return of Flash's black leatherette execution hot pants. Alas, he doesn't have the originals in his possession. No, I don't, he states, but I have the only Flash t-shirt remaining. They made probably 8 or 10 and they were destroyed during the fight scenes, and I have the only one to my knowledge. That's gotta be worth eBaying if times get hard. Back to hot pants and the most pressing unanswered question surrounding the entire film. Were they simply Flash's existing underwear, or did Ming's people slip them on him specifically for the execution ceremony? No one's ever asked me that. I've never even thought of it, he said. I guess you have to say, no matter what you look like, if Ming's going to execute you, they have to put those hot pants on you, I guess. It's a great point. Those are the execution shorts. Why not? Why not look a little Shrek-y before you're executed? Belated reunion with the other Flash. While Flash in hot pants was all Sam Jones, his voice most definitely wasn't. Notoriously, parts of his performance were dubbed by voiceover artist Peter Merenker. There are conflicting reports about why the dubbing took place, with most ultimately suggesting that Jones refused to return for the recording, for one reason or another. Jones suggests it was more to do with his schedule at the time. However, for a long time, the voice actor's identity was considered unknown, including to Jones. Peter Wingard, who played Clytus, last year said he told me he actually knew the guy, said Jones. And then I bumped into a producer and he said, oh, I know the guy. I have his contact information. I said, well, good. Give him my contact information. I'd love to say hi to him. He did a pretty good job. It was hard that time, but it was what it was. I had another job. I couldn't get back to London to do the looping and dubbing, and it turned out the way it was. Jones says he's still waiting to hear from Merenker. So if you're him and you're hearing this, please get in touch. The world needs a Flash reunion. The guy did a good job, he adds. I don't have now, or even then, a James Earl Jones type speaking voice, but I just felt that he was a little bit higher octave than me in some of the scenes. I felt it was a little bit higher than my normal speaking voice, but that's what it was.